surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemy, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church this morning as we come together and worship our Lord and Savior. It's good to have you here this morning, and to those who may be watching online, it's good that y'all can be here with us. If you would, let's turn in our bulletins, and we'll go over a few announcements this morning. Today, after church, we will have cookies and just a time of fellowship here. But today, there is a luncheon for Lenny King, a fundraising luncheon. It's at the City Auditorium today from 11 to 1, I think, is something along that lines. I know they're going to do a silent auction for it, and they're also going to have a live auction for that, and I believe they're doing hamburgers. So please go support that family and be part of that starting at 11 o'clock at the community center. It's always good to support people in our community who are dealing with things like this. So Wednesday night, adult Bible study, 6 o'clock in the parlor. Christian movie night in the fellowship hall. You're never going to let me forget that, are you, Dustin? 7 o'clock, so, wow. Refresh. I think I'm blushing up here a little bit. So next Sunday, regular Sunday of activities here, so we will hope to see you here then. We do have quite a few birthdays. Caleb, happy birthday to you. He's in here somewhere. There he is right there. And so if you see any of these people, wish them happy birthday and happy anniversary. So don't ever forget that. Parents meeting October 9th. Joe, you want to say anything about that at all? Or
so what we're looking at is what is the church vision for the youth program for this church. And so we're looking for folks, not just current parents, but those who have experience and know what we've done in the past and know what's worked, what's not worked, just to get together to talk about this program and see if we can't get some movement going in that ministry in this church. So if you're any interest at all in the youth program, just come. We're just going to talk. I'm not going to ask for volunteers until after. But just come and share, and let's just talk about it. That's what we want to get that discussion started.
Please consider being part of that. Our church has always been faithful in having a youth director on staff. So just come give your point of view on what you'd like to see happen with that program. So speaking of youth, our junior high dance, next one this coming Friday, October 11th. It's homecoming, so we're going to do a homecoming dance for the middle school kids beginning after the football game. And I see that it's 11:30 after we had the dance the other time, it seems like everybody started weeding out about 11:30, so we're going to end it at 11:30 this time. And we need chaperones. Haley says she thinks they have enough cookies and snacks available for that, so we need chaperones, though. So if you can be part of that after the football game Friday night, just come on over with the middle school kids and be here and just help corral them. It's like I said, there's not a whole lot you have to do other than just be present. So just be here and be part of that and love on the kids a little bit. So next Monday, a week from tomorrow, Mom's Heart will be meeting again here at the church from 6 to 8. And so if you want to know more about that, get with Brandy Canock, and she will sure let you know about that. But I believe they have a light meal. Babysitting or nursery provided for the kids that are here, and they feed the kids there as part of that. So just come be a part of that. If you're a mom, if you're a woman, just come be a part of that program and just participate in that. Next Sunday is Pastor Appreciation Sunday, so we would love to show our pastor some appreciation. Just a card shower is all that we're asking. Just write a nice little note, or write a hateful note if that's what you feel, but just make him to know that his presence is felt one way or the other. So we would love to have you be part of that. Just show Daniel some love. Please show him love. Don't show him hate, but we would love to have you just reach out to Daniel in that small way. So October 22nd, we're doing what we do best. We're feeding people. We're going to feed the band this time. Glennis and is kind of taking the lead on Twilight or taking the lead on that. They do need, Glennis told me this morning, they could use a couple of sheet cakes as a dessert. So if you want to do that, please get with her. It's a smaller number of kids, so we don't need 6 or 7 sheet cakes. So please get with her if you have a desire to do that. Get with Glennis, and they'll get that organized. But they need volunteers. That night, unfortunately, is the same night as our next leadership team meeting. So some of our volunteers will be tied up in that, but please be here to help them with that. Joe, you got something?
Yes, we're going to move the leadership team back 30 minutes just to give us some more time, but please come help with the meal.
Okay. All right, are there any other announcements we need to know about this morning? Lindsay?
Just a reminder about our trunk or treat. We are having great signups. Thank you all for doing that. But we still could use a few more trunks. It'll be the 27th of October from 3 to 5.
Yes. Any others this morning? Next Saturday, we do have Loads of Love. We would love to have you be part of that. That is a church mission project. And yes, Melissa and I are usually there, but we would love for others to be involved in that. Here in a month or so, Daniel and I have been talking, and I think we got some things lined up that we're also going to be doing a food distribution as part of Loads of Love. So we got some things going with the food ministry that we're trying to get off the ground on that. So please be in prayer about that with us and that we can make that happen. So we're hoping to come with the November Loads of Love, that we're going to have something like that to make Loads of Love something bigger and better than what it has been, that you all have been faithful to. But it is an easy mission opportunity for you all to come and just put quarters in and talk to people, and that's basically all it is. And if we get the opportunity to pray for them, heck yeah, we jump on it. But it's just a matter of engaging people, so we'd love to have you be part of that. So others this morning. Well, seeing none, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll open up in worship today. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, Lord. And Father God, we praise you for the opportunity to be here. Father, we praise you for laughter, that even in my mistakes, Lord, that we can enjoy one another, we can love on one another. And Father God, we just thank you for the opportunity we have to worship you, honor you, glorify you, Lord, and help us to be careful to do so today. And Father, I pray for those who come before you this morning in the sharing of your word, the singing of song and playing of music, that you bless them as they bless us with their gifts. And Father, we lift up all of this to you. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Amen. Let us enter into worship.
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, and His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, and His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. Will it unmove the mountains? I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. You will move the mountains. I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
So we're starting a new series this week, Hell in the Hallway. It's spooky season, right? It's October. We got to have flames and spooky stuff, right? I figured it'd be fitting for this time of year. But let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for another day of life, another breath to breathe, another opportunity to come and gather together, a day that we can come and be in community. Can come and be in a common unity, that we can come and worship you, that we can come and set aside the busyness of the week, that we can set aside the chaos and hell of our lives to come and worship you, to come sit in your presence. Father, I pray this morning that as your word goes forth, that it would speak to hearts, that it would speak to lives, and Holy Spirit, that you would have your will and that you would have your way and change us as we walk out of this place. In Jesus' name, amen. So how many of you have ever heard the saying, when one door closes, another door opens? How many of you know that's not the complete saying? Like three of you. So it's actually a saying by Alexander Graham Bell. I'm gonna read the quote so I don't mess it up. So it says, when one door closes, another door opens. But we often look so long and so regretfully upon the closed door that we do not see the ones which open for us. And while this statement is true, we're not going to focus on the door that's closed. We're not going to focus on the door that's open. But we're going to focus on that hallway. Sometimes in life, when we are in between seasons of life, or we're in between jobs, or we're in between situations, when one door closes and another door opens, sometimes it's short and sweet, right? We just walk out of this door and then walk into the next door, and it's nice and easy, right? Sometimes it's not so much. Sometimes it's long, and it's dreadful, and it's painful, and it's literally hell in the hallway. Nothing you do, nothing you can try to force. You keep going to the door handles, and they're not opening. Flames are chasing you and burning you on the butt. Yeah. How many of you have ever been there? Just a couple of you. Good. So, this is, like I said, the doors can be metaphorical. Maybe they are between two seasons of life. Maybe it's between two jobs. You get fired, or you quit, and you're waiting for that next one. Maybe it's and I don't even know why I'm getting choked up right now. Y'all, I'm a crier, so. But maybe it's when someone dies. That door closes and you're waiting for that grief to subside just a little bit for that next door to open. Maybe it's a time of loss, something you had, and that door is closing and you're waiting until it's found again for that door to open. Maybe it's a time between relationships or after a divorce or the end of a friendship. It's the time between the mountaintops, what David calls the valley of the shadow of death. Sometimes those spaces are filled with storms that overwhelm us. Today, we're going to look at the tale of two storms, in this example of hell in the hallway. And so just for share a little bit about a storm that I've gone through. In 2019, 2020, we moved our family from Texas to Pennsylvania. 2019 was going well. Then 2020 hit. Who remembers 2020? So at the beginning of the pandemic, I got word that my dad, whom I had not seen in about 20 plus years, was sent home on hospice. He was given 3 weeks to live. On day three, he took a rapid decline. And as I sped from Pennsylvania to Illinois, he passed away before I could get there, before I could see him. And then shortly after this, we received news that Amber's dad's bladder cancer came back after being in remission. And then shortly after this, we received word that my mom, who had been in a nursing home since 2012, was put on hospice as well and given 6 months to live. Wave after wave after wave. And so we made the decision to move back from Pennsylvania, back to Texas, to be close to family. And then shortly after we were back in Texas, we received word that Amber's mom, the epitome of health and faith, was diagnosed with a stage 4 glioblastoma, given 6 weeks to live. Talk about a rogue wave. And then in Thanksgiving Day, that morning of 2020, she passed away. And then come into 2021, just a week shy of the 1 year anniversary of when my dad passed away, my mom passed away. So three parents gone in 1 year. Wave after wave after wave, rogue wave. It was a storm. And I'm going to share more about that in a couple of weeks. Do we have any Kleenex somewhere? Sorry, y'all. I'm a crier and a snotter. And so I'm going to share more about this in a few weeks, so y'all get to see me snot and cry some more. This thing is smarter than me. I don't know how to open it. Anyways, but Seneca, you'll notice I like to quote Stoic philosophers a lot. I normally have mine, but I don't have it this morning. But Seneca said, "It does not matter what you bear, but how you bear it." Or as Dean Acheson put it, the manner in which one endures is more important than the thing that must be endured. And I can say with honesty that there are parts of that storm that I handled well. But there are parts of it that I handled very poorly. All that to say, the storms of life are inevitable. We will face storms in life. And when you are in the hallway of life and the storms of chaos and hell are raging around you, I hope and my prayer is that you will take what we're going to talk about today with you and hold on to it. So, on a lighter note, I need a volunteer. Come on down. What's your name?
Carson.
Carson? All right, Carson. You get the important job of playing Jesus.
Okay.
Okay? Oh, she's like, all right. All right, and this is your chance to sleep in church without any judgment.
Really?
Yep, so just go right over here and take a nap. Okay? She's like, done. Yes. So, all right. And perfect, that's what you're going to do. I'll come find you in a minute. So, tale of two storms. Storm one, let's look at Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 through 27. And this is paralleled in Mark 4 and in Luke 8. We read the story of Jesus and the disciples. They're getting in the boat. They're getting ready to go to the other side of the sea. And then a storm hits. Okay, so let's read Matthew. He says, when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being covered with the waves. But Jesus himself was asleep. And they came to him and woke him, saying, save us, Lord, we are perishing. And he said to them, why are you afraid, you men of little faith? And he got up, rebuked the winds and the sea, and it became perfectly calm. The men were amazed and said, what kind of a man is this, that even the winds and sea obey him? So let's look at what's happening here. So the Sea of Galilee is actually far below sea level, and it's surrounded by these giant hills and these deep ravines. And so sudden storms, these strong storms, were pretty common. They would come up unexpectedly. We don't know what kind of boat they were in, and we don't know who exactly was on the boat with Jesus in this scenario, but we do know that four of the disciples were former professional fishermen, right? So they were used to this. They would know how to handle the water. They would know how to handle a storm. And there's that old saying that time is relative, right? That time flies when you're having fun. But then when you're in those moments of panic and distress, Derek, you were telling me your son had a wreck the other day. Like when you're in the middle of a wreck, everything is like, and you're just like moving in slow motion, right? It's everything just slows down. And so I'm sure for the disciples, everything was just like wave. And everything's just moving in slow motion for them. But think about this. You're a trained fisherman, okay? You're used to handling storms. Like, this wasn't a rare occurrence. This was common because of the geography of what's happening in the land. And it says, verse 24 tells us their boat was being covered with waves. You're in such a bad storm that the waves are like covering your boat. You're a trained fisherman who's used to fishing on this water in these storms, and yet this storm was so bad that even these disciples started panicking. Like, how bad does it have to be that you're used to this? This was your job for a living, and you're panicking. So you know it's pretty rough, right? It's not just like, oh, a little gale, oh, a little wind. No, it's pretty rough. They're going through some hell, aren't they? Right? There's just chaos happening all around them. This is where I can relate to the disciples that, like, man, I've seen some stuff, been through some stuff. But man, that storm of 2020, I was kind of like the disciples. I was kind of panicking and losing my mind. And so a common practice back in that day was that when there's a storm, what do? They started chunking stuff overboard. Get rid of the cargo, get rid of the nets, get rid of anything that's heavy, get it overboard. We see this in Acts 27 with Paul. When he's going, they start chunking all the cargo overboard. Because they're trying to do anything they can to lighten the boat, to keep themselves safe. The disciples are running around, they're losing their minds, throwing stuff overboard. Where's Jesus? Taking a nap. Has it ever felt like that for you? Have you ever been there? Or you're in the midst of a storm, you're losing your mind, the storms of life are raging around you, it's hell and chaos. Where's Jesus? just hear the crickets, like the one that was in our garage the other night, so loud, echoing off the concrete. So the disciples are running around, they're tossing crates and nets and goods overboard, and they're freaking out to the max, and then finally they run below deck, and they're like, Jesus, save us! Just making sure y'all are awake. Thank you. That's all I needed you for. I just wanted to come over and shake you and scream and Jesus. You can go back to the child. Let's give her a hand. That's all I wanted for. It's interactive, y'all. Jesus gets up from his nap. He's just like, rolling his eyes and just nonchalantly is like, why are you freaking out? Like, why are you afraid? You man up little face. He gets up and he rebukes the winds and the seas, and it says that it becomes perfectly calm. And then I just envision Jesus like going to crawl back into the stern of the boat, and he just goes back to sleep. He's like, y'all woke me up. He's like, the waves had just like rocked me to sleep, and I was feeling good. And then you come and wake me up for this. And he goes and crawls back and takes his nap. Just like it's any other Tuesday. But how many times are we like the disciples? We've seen Jesus do stuff. We've walked with Jesus. Y'all, I've seen people get healed of diseases and sicknesses. I've seen my stillborn nephew raised to life. I've seen miraculous provision. But something about this storm that hit us in 2020 rocked my boat. That's what happens, right? Those storms of life are inevitable. Sometimes they're little storms, but sometimes they're big storms. The waves start covering your boat. And you're going through hell, and all the while, Jesus is over here taking a nap. He's not listening to you. He's not helping to toss cargo overboard. He's not getting a bucket and scooping water out. You try to say a prayer and a wave just comes and like washes it away. And you're like, there goes my prayer. Out and back into the ocean. Back into the chaos. Where's Jesus? Still over there taking his nap. You're going through hell. And Jesus is taking a nap. But here's the lesson. Here's the thing that I want you to take away from all of this. That we missed out on, that the disciples missed out on. Are you ready? You got your pens and papers? Phones? Jesus is already in the boat. Jesus is already in the boat with you. Let me say that again. Jesus is already in the boat. What do you or I have to worry about? Is this the storm that's going to take us down? Is this financial trouble? Is this relationship issue? Is this death? Is this sickness? Is this the thing that's really going to take us down, that's going to sink our boat? Jesus is already in the boat with us. Jesus would say, oh, us of little faith. Why are you afraid? After all that you've seen him do, after all that you've experienced, after all of the faithfulness, is this really it? And I get it. I was there. When you're in the middle of the storm and the waves are coming, and those rogue waves are coming and coming over the top of your boat and the water's filling up fast, it gets scary and it gets hard. because there's no land anywhere in sight. And the waves just keep coming, one after the other. It's a scary place to be. But Jesus is already in the boat. And if he's not worried about it, if he's so relaxed that in the midst of chaos and hell, he can take a nap, should we be worried? See, because Jesus was practicing this art of stillness in the storm. And that's what he was trying to teach us. Instead of losing our minds when we're going through hell, instead of trying to fight the waves and fight the water and fight the chaos, we need to be still. In the ancient world, water and waves represented chaos. And in Psalm 69, we see David saying, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in the miry depths where there is no foothold. I have come into the deep waters. The floods engulf me. I am worn out calling for help. My throat is parched. My eyes fail looking for my God." David is stressed and panicking. He's crying out to God. The imagery here kind of mirrors what the disciples are going through. He says, the water is up to my neck, or the waves are crashing over my boat. My eyes fail looking for God. My eyes fail looking for Jesus. Where is he? But the psalmist tells us in 46:10, cease striving and know that I am God. Stop trying to do all the things. Stop trying to toss everything overboard. Stop trying to fight the waves. Stop trying to fight the chaos. And just be still. See, if we look at the story of Joshua 3, the Israelites are preparing to cross the Jordan. And this isn't just any time of year. This is a rainy season. Verse 15 tells us that the banks are overflowing. But in verse 8, the Lord tells Joshua, remember, water and waves represent chaos. And the Lord tells Joshua, he says, when you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan. Like I said, these aren't just regular waters. This is the rainy season. This is when the banks are overflowing. Because God's not just saying, I'm powerful enough in the calm times of your life, but I'm powerful enough in the chaos and in the hell, and when everything's out of control, when the banks are overflowing, when the waves are coming over your boat. That is when we need to come to the water and be still. When we come to the waters of chaos in our life, we need to come and be still. Or as Ryan Holiday put it in his book, stillness is the key. So when you're going through hell and when chaos and the waves are crashing over you, remember, Jesus is already in the boat. What if Jesus isn't in the boat? Remember, this is a tale of two storms. So let's look at our second storm. We're going to jump forward a few chapters to Matthew 14. It says, immediately afterward, he compelled the disciples to get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he sent the crowds away. After he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray, and when it was evening, he was there alone. But the boat was already a long distance from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter responded and said to him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But seeing the wind, he became frightened, And when he began to sink, he cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind stopped, and those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "You are truly God's son." So we see this same imagery here. Chaos happening all around him. The disciples are going through hell. Their boat is being battered by the waves and by chaos. And here comes Jesus in the early hours of the morning walking on the water. And they think he's a ghost, right? The reason why they thought he was a ghost was because the Gentiles and even some of the Jews often thought that when somebody drowned, that their ghost would hover above that spot in the water. And even though it contradicted the mainstream Jewish views on the afterlife, the disciples were aware of these stories. They were aware of these belief systems and these things. And surely they're sitting there and they're drawing that up in their mind and they're like, somebody drowned there. There's a ghost hovering above that spot. It's coming towards us. And it's the early hours of the morning. The Romans split the night into four watches. And so this is the fourth watch. So it's like those early hours of twilight right before sunrise. So Jesus is coming from the east. So it would have been easier to see. The light would have been kind of coming up on him, make him look more like a ghost. Probably has some implications about his second coming from the east, but that's not for today. But as he's coming towards them, the disciples are losing their minds. Again, panicking, just like in our previous storm. And he says, "Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." He's literally saying, "I am." Although it can mean, "it is I," this context, the activity of this context, is alluding to Jesus' deity. And then Peter says, "Tell me to come to you. Tell me to come out on the water with you." So he would have been raised on the Jewish scriptures. He would have known them by heart, and he would be drawing into his mind and into his imagination those words spoken to Joshua that we read just a little bit ago. When you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan. And he would be drawing into this holy imagination the pictures of the waters of Exodus and Joshua when they're stopped and when they're parted. And see, he didn't have a concept of water being able to hold a person's body weight, right? We all know, like, you step in water and you're gonna go through it. But I'm sure he's standing there and he's thinking about these scriptures and he's seeing Jesus doing it, and so he's processing, and you like see the wheels turning and like 2 and 10 are coming together, and he's like, "Well, if he can do it and God did this, I think I can carry the 3, 14, 7. I think I can do this too, maybe." Right? All in this time of getting out of the boat and getting out there. And so we see him make this attempt. And so in the midst of chaos and hell that's happening around him, he attempts the impossible. But that's not our point. That's a good point, but that's not our point for today. What happens after that is our point for today that I want us to focus on with this second storm. Jesus wasn't in the boat, but then what happened? He got in the boat. Jesus was already coming to the boat. He was already coming to their boat, but the disciples had to make the choice to let him get into the boat. Just like we read in Revelation. Remember this, that's what you were pointing out last time. "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Will you let me in? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. I'm at the edge of your boat. You have hell and chaos happening around you, raging around you. The waves are coming over your boat. Your boat is being battered by the waves. Will you let me into the boat?" You see, in the game of hide and seek, God has always been the seeker. Jesus has always been the seeker. He's already coming to your boat. And it tells us he brought stillness with him when he got into the boat. The winds and the wave became still. The disciples would have again recognized God's power to calm the sea. They would recognize Jesus' power to calm the chaos and the hell that was happening around them. And so when you're going through hell, when you're going through chaos, when you are stuck between shores, it's about your attitude and your actions in the midst of what you're going through. Difficulties, hardships, setbacks, failures, death, sickness, war, financial troubles, all of these things are inevitable. You may not encounter all of them. You may encounter all of them. You may encounter all of them at once. And it's not that we have to endure them, but it's more important how we endure them. See, our testimony of getting through life's afflictions and difficulties, what does our testimony have if we just gripe and complain our way through it? Listen, y'all, I get it. I failed that test. But our testimony gains authenticity and power and veracity when we endure it with the right attitude and the right outlook. And this isn't to say you can never have a moment of despairing. It's not to say you can't ever have a negative outlook. But what is the sum of the parts? What is the average temperament of all the days of endurance? Our resiliency is determined by our mindset. Because we can't control the waves. We can't control the chaos. We can't control when hell is happening around us, but what we can do is control how we respond to it. We can freak out and lose our minds like the disciples did and start throwing things overboard or thinking it's a ghost or whatever. Or we can, hey, Jesus is in the boat. What do I have to fear? What do we have to worry about if Jesus is in the boat? Or in our second storm, if he's not in the boat, get him in the boat. He's already coming towards your boat. Let him in. And this isn't to say, get Jesus in the boat and then everything's going to be hunky-dory and everything's going to be calm and perfect. No, because the disciples walked with Jesus every day. They followed him. They had seen some things. But even they still were panicking and losing their minds in that situation. It's that blessed assurance that even when the storms of chaos and hell are raging around us, that if Jesus is comfortable enough in that to take a nap, do we have anything to worry about? That's where we can practice that stillness that he shows us in the midst of the chaos and the hell in the hallway. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that even in the midst of chaos, even in the midst of hardship and difficulty, even in the midst of our world falling apart when the waves are crashing over our boat, that we have nothing to fear because you are with us. You are in the boat with us. And Jesus, if you're not in the boat with us, We invite you in. Because we know you're a gentleman. You're not going to barge your way in. And so we invite you in, Jesus. Amen. So we participate in an ancient future faith. Scripture tells us that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses who have gone before us as we journey into, sorry, there's like a goop from the sanitizer that's like stuck on my hand. As we have traditions and things from our past that we can hold on to as we journey into the future. And so we take our past, our ancient history, and our future, and we pull them into tension, and we live in that tension. When strings are under tension, like on a piano or a guitar, they what? They make music. They sing. And so we live in that tension, and we live in the beauty of the music that tension brings. And so as we prepare our hearts for communion, I want us to practice the instructions of Paul and both confess with our mouths where we've missed God's highest good, but also to proclaim our faith together. And I'm not going to pretend that I came up with this idea on my own. Churches have been doing this for a long time. But I saw a service the other day where they did this. They had a time of confession together and a time of proclamation of their faith together. And so that's what I want us to do today, together. Because there's power when we do it in that common unity, in community, right? When our voices reverberate together when we do that. And so I've pulled together a couple of liturgies from online to give us just a confession. And then they'll be up on the screen in just a minute. And then we're going to proclaim our faith together, which is just the Apostles' Creed. And this is something that we talked about, that we put in our bylaws, because it's something that we believe. And so if you will, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. So let us confess together where we've missed God's highest good. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. Forgive us, renew us, lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways that lead to the glory of your name. Amen. And now let us proclaim our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who has conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting.
Amen. And for those of you that might take alarm at the Holy Catholic Church, that's just talking about the universal church. It's not talking about the Catholic Church. We're not changing our denomination and to become Catholic. I know that kind of throws some people off, but those simple confessions and proclamations, when we say them with heartfelt sincerity, That is a simple way to say, Jesus, get into my boat. Jesus, get into our boat. And so on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and do this in remembrance of me. And then he took the cup and said, this is the blood of my new covenant. Take and do this in remembrance of me. So this communion table is open to all, as Jesus would open his table to all. At his table, he would bring political opponents, socioeconomic differences, different education levels, enemies, friends, and neighbors. We're all welcome. And so you are at our table. And so I invite you to come and partake. The body of Christ is broken for you, and the blood of Christ is shed for you. And so as you get your elements, you can stay at the altar, you can return to your seat, but take just a moment to remember Jesus. And then you can take your elements as you feel led. Some ushers will come.
Now's the time in our service where we do have an opportunity to give back to our good Lord and Savior a small amount of with our tithes and offerings this morning. If you would, bow with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, and we acknowledge the fact that you are the giver of all things, Lord. And Father, we pray for our faithfulness in giving back to you, and we pray that you use these funds to further your kingdom. And Father, as we put forth these monies to finance the missions and the ministries that you call us into, Lord, and we lift this up to you and your blessings. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Amen.
Praise him above ye heavens.
Susan, you just gave me goosebumps with that song, man. Wow. How great is our God. Now's the opportunity we get a chance to let Jesus in the boat. We get to share our joys and concerns with one another. So if you have a joy or you have a concern, please stand and the ushers will bring you a mic. Don't listen to him.
I have some concerns besides Gary. One is for Josh Thompson. He's having a really critical surgery tomorrow. He's at Houston at MD Anderson. Just keep him and the family in your prayers. And also Samantha's sister's, well, his husband now, they had their rehearsal dinner and they left from it on Thursday night. Was supposed to get married Friday. And a big truck ran a stop sign, T-boned him. And he's in critical condition in Houston in the hospital. But he woke up long enough and they got married in the hospital. But he's got a long ways to go. So keep them in your prayers too.
Who did you say that was?
It was my daughter-in-law's sister's husband.
Others. Edwina.
I think I'm at the end of a hallway and ready to go into a bright, shiny room. We had services, private services for Julie this week, and Daniel was there. It was a beautiful tribute to Julie, and I thank everyone for their prayers.
Terry.
I'm just happy to have our daughter and granddaughter, Rosie, here today. Hurricane's coming back into Florida, so they may be an extra day here, but 2 days, we'll take it.
Yeah.
As long as everybody there's safe. And an extra prayer for my dad. He had a back procedure that will eventually help, but he's having some rough days. Thank you.
Catherine is traveling back east on the East Coast this week, and I would just like prayers for her safe travels and return.
How's what? Ray, I talked to him yesterday, and he's still recovering. He fell, and he did hit his head, but overall, he seems to be doing good. He wants to be here at church, but he's still a little sore and doesn't feel like he can be here. So thank you for asking. Twyla.
My brother, Eddie Grable, is in the hospital in Oklahoma City. I think he will probably get to come home Wednesday, but he gave us quite a scare. And I just praise God for the answered prayers.
Esther is in Tulsa this weekend with her daughter, and she asked that I give the football report. my football report is Fairview Yellow Jackets did a great job Friday night, and this week's homecoming, so I invite you all to come see them play again Friday night at home, 7 o'clock.
Daniel's asking if you found any quarters on the track or anything. Pennies. Cass.
Our band has been performing like crazy. They got second place in their division or whatever on Saturday, and they don't get much sleep, so keep them in mind.
Yeah, amen. Congratulations. Others. If you notice on the back, Susan Overstreet is on our prayer list, and they found a blood clot in her lungs, so she's in Oklahoma City. Continue to lift her up in prayers. She's dealing with so much, and so just continue to lift her up in prayers that they can deal with that. Others this morning. Any prayers you'd like to make, unspoken prayers you'd like to make known by raising of a hand? Lots of them. Well, the altars will still be open for you if you feel led to come forward as Pastor Daniel comes and shares a prayer.
I will say this. I went to see Ray on Monday or Tuesday this last week, and that man, for being 99 and having just fallen and he had some scrapes and bonks and everything. He has the most positive, like, go get him attitude out of anyone I've ever seen. And just getting to sit with him for a little bit was encouraging to me. He's like, oh, and he's like, I want to be there. He's like, I just need to get my strength back up and I'll be there. And like, he's just, for 99, he's just ready to go. And he's awesome. I love Ray. I love you all, but I love Ray too. But all right, let's pray. Also, before we pray, you'll notice our church this week is Fresh Start Fellowship here in Fairview. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the opportunity that we can come together, that we can pray together, that we can see each other through these hallways. When there's hell of cancer, there's hell and chaos of blood clots and car wrecks, when there's falls and spills and illnesses and disease and things that are happening around us, Jesus, I thank you that we can come together and lift up our church family, that we can lift them up to you, Jesus, just like the friends, that we can peel back the layers of the roof and bring our friends before you. As we intercede for them, Jesus, we ask that you would bring healing. We ask that you would bring peace, that you would bring comfort. Where bodies are not aligned with how you intended our bodies to be, Jesus, bring it back into alignment. Holy Spirit, bring comfort to those who are mourning, to those who are dealing with disaster and chaos and hell. Jesus, I thank you that we don't have to invite you in, that we don't have to try to conjure you and get you to come from heaven, but that you are already with us. So in the midst of sickness, in the midst of chaos, in the midst of hell that is happening around us, make us aware of your presence. Make these, our family and our friends, aware of your presence in the midst of the chaos and the hell that they are going through. Jesus, we lift them up and we lay them at your feet, that you would bless them, that you would anoint them, that you would breathe new life into them. We pray for Fresh Start Fellowship here in Fairview, that their time together would be anointed and blessed, Jesus, that they would have an experience and an encounter with you like they've never known before. Let their worship arise to you. Let their word go forth. Let their lives be changed because of what you're doing in their midst. And Jesus, we join together in the way that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now let's rise for our closing hymn, number 377, It Is Well With My Soul.
It is well with my soul. with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but
that song, wow, that's loud. That song is even more powerful when you know the story behind it. That Horatio Spafford wrote this song after the Great Chicago Fire nearly destroyed his family and his wealth and all of his possessions. Just a few years later, he sent his wife and his daughters on a ship to England, and that ship crashed, and his daughters died. Some hell in the hallway, isn't it? He gets a telegraph from his wife that she's alone, that she survived. And so as he's on the boat going over to England, he comes over the spot where his daughters died, and he pens this song. It is well with my soul. Jesus is in the boat. Amen. All right, my friends. We take our two fingers and we cross them. And as I bless you, bless one another, that Christ would have the victory in our lives this week, and that we would remember that Jesus is in the boat. So Christus Victor. Christus Victor, Christus Victor. May Christ have the victory in your lives, my friends. Love you. Have a great week.